When the world made its peace and the Games returned in 1948, the battered city of London offered them the warmest of welcomes. Despite a dozen years of strife and confusion, the Olympic spirit had somehow survived. For Harrison Dillard, the Olympic dream was born on an afternoon in 1936, when Jesse Owens came home in triumph from Berlin. Cleveland turned out to greet its favorite son, and on one corner, a small boy stood with his friends and watched the parade.
Jesse looked down and winked, said, "Hi, kids, how are you?" We just thought this was the greatest thing in the world, that Jesse Owens, who was our idol, had actually spoken to us. And so we ran back home, and I remember saying, "Mama, Mama, I just saw Jesse Owens. I'm going to be just like him." She said, "Yes, son, I'm sure you will be."
Mrs. Dillard let the child dream. And why not? Reality was the abject poverty of the Depression years. Why not dream of being Jesse Owens? Yet when she looked at her son, she found it hard to imagine him as a great athlete. His name was Harrison, but he was so frail and slender that his friends called him Bones. In 1941, when Bones Dillard had developed into a promising high school hurdler, he met his hero. Owens gave him a new pair of track shoes to encourage his progress. In those shoes, Dillard won two state hurdles titles. After wartime service as an infantryman in Italy, Dillard returned to civilian life and joined forces with his college coach, Eddie Finnegan. Together, they started to plan for the 1948 Olympics. In June 1947, he began a series of 82 straight victories at sprints and hurdles. Dillard was no longer a hopeful dreamer. He had become a firm Olympic favorite. But when Dillard competed in the US Olympic trials, his blazing form had begun to fade. Then, as now, the rules were simple. First three make the team, the rest stay at home. On Friday evening, he made the squad at 100 meters, just. Barney Ewell equaled the world record of 10.2 seconds. The brilliant Mel Patton was second. Dillard squeezed through in third place. But the high hurdles lay ahead, and it seemed that only a disaster could deprive the fastest hurdler in the world of an Olympic place in his favorite event. That disaster duly arrived. So the man who had been regarded as a certainty for the high hurdles title would journey to London only as a rank outsider in the 100 meters. The fact that there were any games at all after the hardships of war was a tribute to the British organizers, and they found their reward when the games opened on a beautiful July day. The Dutch housewife, Fanny Blankers-Koen, and a Czech soldier, Emil Zatopek, were among the favorites for medals. No one mentioned Harrison Dillard, the shy youngster from Cleveland. His confidence grew during the 100 meters heats, especially after beating Barney Ewell in the semi-final, but it was something else which convinced him the gold medal would be his.
I just had this premonition, this vision. I saw myself crossing the tape, winning a race, and I told Barney, "Barney, I'm going to beat you on Saturday," and he just kind of laughed it off. He thought I was maybe trying to psych him out or something.
Dillard was certain, so certain that he actually took a 20-minute nap in the dressing room before the race. It was the biggest event of his life, yet he was utterly relaxed. Even a false start couldn't upset him.
Then the nervous sprinters returned to their marks as the huge crowd, cramming every seat in the stadium, settled down once again in a hushed expectancy. On their marks, set, and they're off, with Dillard on the outside getting away in front. Now as we watch the race in slow motion, left to right, it's Dillard, Bailey, McCorkadale, LaBeach, Ewell, and Patton. Dillard still holds his lead, with Ewell resolutely closing ground. At the tape, it's a photo finish. The winner was Harrison Dillard, who equaled the Olympic record of 10.3.
The only tactic that I had was that I had to have a good start. I think the film showed I was out in front after a couple of strides. As I remember, Barney jumped up and down, clasping his hands over his head, acting as though he had won. And I think he used it to influence the judges. And I suppose it's fortunate for me that this was the first time that they used the photoelectrical timing devices in major international competition. Lloyd LaBeach from Panama was finished maybe a meter or so back, and as a consequence, he had a pretty good angle to make a judgment. Lloyd was able to tell Barney that he says, "Barney, man," he says, "you don't win." He says, "Bones win."
So the kid who had waved to Jesse Owens was now the fastest man on earth. He found further consolation for his absence from the hurdles when he ran the third leg of a convincing American victory in the sprint relay. although Dillard received that second gold medal only after the judges revised a decision to disqualify the Americans for an illegal baton change. Cleveland gave Dillard the kind of reception that Owens had received all those years earlier, and the city and Jesse showed their appreciation. The Cleveland Indians Baseball Club gave him a job in public relations. This allowed him time to prepare for the 1952 Olympics, where he offered an exhibition of high hurdling which came close to perfection, and he was also a member of the winning American relay squad. Like Owens, his hero, Dillard could now boast four gold medals. Harrison Dillard retired from athletics in 1956 at the age of 33. For a while, he moved from job to job, but in the mid-60s, he joined the Cleveland Board of Education, and he's there still, responsible for the maintenance of the city's schools.
It's a very difficult event.
These days, Dillard is the model citizen, the man who works with young people and plays his full part in the church and community affairs of Cleveland. And they've never forgotten the man who emulated Jesse Owens.
You gonna come in shape?
Yes!
I think you'll do it too.